Hi, this is Mac, MacSierra29. Today I wanted to review for you the Thunder Tiger EB4G3. I got this buggy just before Thanksgiving, and so I've had it roughly 5 months, and in that time I probably put 20 packs through it, battery packs through it, and normally I would have done more than that, but I live in Washington and it has rained nonstop this spring. So it took me a little longer to try to get enough packs to really get an idea of how this thing goes. Usually what I've been trying to do is if I get a kit, I would give an initial like review of how I thought it would hold up over like the first month or so, and then 6 months. So this is kind of like my first review, and then I'd like to do a longer term one later still. So anyway, I did an unboxing of this. So just to recap, it's a 8-scale brushless electric buggy. It comes ready to run with everything besides the battery. And one of the things about it, you probably saw before, is it has this top plate case to hold the battery in, and it's a just your standard like 40 by 74 brushless motor. It's a 4S capable speed controller. It's rated at 80 amps continuous. It's sufficient for this this power. This motor delivers enough current and it doesn't overheat or anything. It has a fan built in. It's a just about the bottom level you can put in this, I think. I did upgrade the servo. This is a Spectrum S6030. It's 278 inch ounces. It's like 0.15 speed at 6 volts. And the VC on the speed controller is 6 volts. I think it's like 5.75, and it's like a 2 or 3 amp. I think it's a 3 amp VC. I do run a Glitch Buster just to be on the safe side, and I made my own. You can buy capacitors fairly cheap at electronic stores, solder some servo leads on it. Anyway, I kind of went over the shocks and everything before. I didn't want to go over too much, but basically just kind of wanted to give everyone an idea of just the durability, what I like about it. So going from the MT4, which was a monster truck version of this, it's got a longer wheelbase and a higher ground clearance, mainly from the tires, and it's got longer A-arms. It's going to push down a little more. So it doesn't quite go over the rough terrain like the monster truck does. That's pretty obvious. But it does go pretty well. I mean, I'm pretty surprised at how well it does. The things I miss about bashing with this versus the monster truck is backflips and wheelies and stuff like that. I could probably put thicker oil in the middle to get this thing to wheelie, but I kind of been trying to like save the drivetrain a little bit too. I have 100,000 weight silicon oil in the center diff, and then I just have the grease in the front and rear. I don't care about the tuning of it. I just kind of want it to be a more of an open feel, so it can at least turn. I thought about putting some like maybe 5,000 or 7,000 in the front and rear, just to give it a little more consistency, but I haven't really bothered. Probably won't. I don't know. We'll see. So durability wise, I have not broken one thing on this. I have some running videos up. Most of the packs I've run have been in that exact spashing spot, jumping it. I don't get too crazy with it. I launch it maybe this highest. I think I've had it, it's maybe 8 feet in the air. But I've done like 30-foot cartwheels and pretty hard off balance lands, just front, back. Oh, I take it back. I did break one part. I broke this rear toe block right here. I snapped it they give you different toe blocks for this, and just they give you different degrees, so you can go toe in or toe out, basically. This one here is like a half a degree more of a toe in than the stock. I just threw that one on. It wasn't a big deal for what I do. It doesn't matter. If you're a racer, you're probably not gonna buy this kit anyways, but this part's like $6, and they give you like all four of them. So, or you can go aluminum. I didn't think it was that necessary. So, I guess I should say I am mostly a basher. I have had this at a clay track. It did okay, but I go a couple times a year, so how it handles compared to what other things could do, I'm the worst person to ask. And but I had fun with it at the track. It did, you know, like I said, I can get around the track, hit the jumps, and it was pretty fun. You know, it does take just your standard 8-scale buggy wheels. And so what I have on here now are these Supra sails. They're kind of like I think they're called Big Blocks or something like that. They're kind of a Badlands knockoff. They were like $25 shipped for all four, which is a pretty screaming deal. The stock tires are these kind of like crime fighter knockoffs. And just your standard, you know, knobby tires. They did pretty good. I mean, I haven't really noticed a huge difference in traction from these to these on dirt, you know, on running in such uneven, you know, it's like gravel to grass to almost mud to whatever, so it just kind of like goes all over the place all the time anyways. And they kind of do the same on pavement, but you know, probably push come to shove, if I were to really pay close attention, these do get better traction. But I kind of thought what I'd do is just burn these up on pavement and kind of make them like slicks or something. I don't know. I couldn't really keep the tires glued on there very well. They just, no matter what I did, they just pop off. I would kind of clean them up and put rubbing alcohol in there. And I even put venting holes in them. They didn't have venting holes in here. And I don't know. Just couldn't keep them glued. That was the main reason why I get different tires. But if you're just bashing around, I don't think that it's necessary to upgrade the tires, be honest, unless you just, you know, obviously you're gonna ball these out on pavement pretty fast. The other thing that's kind of falling apart, I wouldn't call it an actual break, but this wing is kind of coming apart right here. But for the kind of driving I do, I don't even notice it. I'm just gonna wait for it to completely disintegrate. I don't really need the wing action too much anyways. You know, it's not really doing me a whole lot of good. So it drives great. It turns over, like it flips over on its lid a lot more than the MT4 G3 did. And I think mainly maybe the width, the MT4 is wider. It's also, you know, relative to the height and the size of this to the MT4, it's a lot narrower. And and the wheels are a little bit smaller, so instead of like going over like a lump of grass or like a little soft part of a divot of dirt, you know, where the tire would kind of sink in and dig, it would just kind of flip this thing over instead of just rolling over it. And I think that's probably the main reason why it ends up on its lid a little more. It's also lighter, so instead of like just, you know, going over something, it would just start getting all bouncy. So other than, and I, you know, I'm just nailing the throttle and spinning around and, you know, goofing off. So it's not like I'm really trying to keep the thing too much under control. And the things that you would probably really like, if you were to try to race this at all, is it's got a fair amount of tuning to it. You know, you can do the shock positions and you can do a slight wheelbase adjustment, some caster, and I don't know if it's caster so much as, you know, you can pivot these pillow balls back and forth with these little E-clip things. And it's got, you know, tie rods that you can adjust your camber. And you can put sway bars on this thing and stuff like that. I guess the only other thing is, think more at the track than anywhere else. I kind of bent the shock towers a little bit. They were just kind of a little bit dink, and I took some vice grips and put some like an old Shure or some cardboard to protect it, and just kind of shoved it over a little bit and got it straight just by eyeballing it. I haven't really had a big issue since then with it bending too much, or maybe I'm just not paying that close attention. But I have considered just doubling up the shock towers on the front and rear just to see. I think I can probably fit them on both sides. The front, you'd probably just lose these little spacers I was talking about, where you can pivot this front, this top A-arm back and forth. You would probably lose that adjustability because I think it would take about the same amount of space. But that also allows you to fit that in there. You know, if you took those out, you can kind of just push it up a little bit. I don't know. We'll see. Or just you'd be forced to push it all the way forward and you'd have to put the spacers in the back, I guess. I haven't really thought about it too much, but there's always those options, you know, you bending them up. Two's better than one, I would say. And so other than that, the body has held up okay. The weakest part of the body is this back hole, and it just tears right here, and it's starting to tear here. I tried putting some like drywall tape and shoe goo stuff, and it kind of, it's such a small space to protect. There's not a lot of, you know, extra material you can add to protect it. So I went redneck and duct taped it because I'm not in a, you know, a show or a styling contest. So I just figured duct tape, and that seems to be holding up okay. And so just the other thing I wanted to show is what I've done with the battery compartment. Is I added a little piece of some like foamy weather stripping to the side and to the back, and I cut out that little piece of plastic that kind of is there, the stock stop to keep the battery from sliding back and forth. I noticed that my battery case broke. It's kind of like slamming up against that, so I cut that out and put foam. A little softer, and then also from it sliding side to side, my batteries are a little smaller, so I put that foam piece there. So what I end up doing is sliding the battery in, of course now I'm talking, there, and it's kind of a more of a snug fit, and I lay it on its side. You can get it to sit like that, and so I also cut these holes out bigger. And the stock way of, to backtrack a second, the stock setup is with Deans, and the way the manual kind of describes is you would run your battery leads through this little channel. You can see this, whoop, underneath the CVD there. It's a CVD, but it's like the drive line. Underneath that, it's awfully close to that moving shaft, and then it's kind of a pain to kind of slip that underneath there. So I cut these out and I just run that lead through there. And you can either put your battery in, oh, this is a Turnigy 20C 5,000 milliamp hour 4S battery. It's like $20. And I don't want anyone to argue with me about how it's not enough battery for this thing. It has worked fine with me for years running these kind of batteries in skill trucks. So everyone always argues, oh, that's not enough. See, you're going to fry something. And whatever. I could be dead wrong, but I don't care about anyone's opinion about it, really. But that will kind of fit. It's a little bit of a tight squeeze because the battery's not quite square. Like, square around the, what do you call it? The girth. But it can fit. And then plug it in, and then, but it does fit better if you put it in this way, and then you can run your balancing plug here and kind of do the same thing because it's a little shallower on the sides. fit just a hair easier. You probably can't tell because I'm holding around, but there was a kind of a little bow, a bulge there across the top, and that fits like that, and then you can plug it in and stick your body on, and it's all covered up, and so it's no big deal. And then, so the other batteries that I've been running is I have this older 4500 milliamp hour 30C Turnigy, and I have this old, I've had this, I think this is my oldest battery, it's a Jin's Ace. I took it apart for something, I can't remember why, maybe the battery casing just started to crack. Can't remember. I've taken so many batteries apart and fixed things inside of them. I can't remember what I did with this one here, but it's, I don't know if you could tell, I'll try to hold up these. The difference in the size there, it's almost a quarter inch in difference in height, but the, you know, this way, it's almost the same. So, it doesn't, if I took this weather stripping out, it would fit in here this way, I believe. Let me just double check that. Yeah, it would fit that way, but it won't fit this way at all. It's way too tall. So I could run this battery, but I haven't really cared too much about it because I'm only getting like 3,500 milliamp hour capacity out of it. Though I stopped using it. I think I just have it in storage mode and I haven't used it in a while. Just kind of been holding on to it as a backup, just in case one of these things wears out or something happens. So that's kind of what I run, 4S. I have never tried 5 or 6S LiPos in this thing. I have never purchased that size of a battery before, so I don't know what would fit. There is a website, wondertiger.com. It's kind of, was a guy started this site for the MT4. But now there's some topics on there, like the this thing is on there, and the D8T, some guy did a conversion, and they have like some different sections that you can discuss those vehicles. So some of those guys, I think, have this kit and the MT4, and they might have played around with battery configurations. You probably have to go soft pack if you went bigger. Another thing you can do is you can modify this tray and just run Velcro straps if you want to get crazy with batteries. Just, you know, whatever. So, I have, there's some guys with the MT4, they run a chassis brace. I didn't do that with the MT4, and I haven't really decided to do that with this yet. I have torn up the bottom of the chassis pretty good, like from running over in gravel and rocks, but haven't really bent the chassis. And, but, you know, I'm assuming there's guys that are way crazier than I am that might be bending stuff or whatever, but I don't really run into trees and curves and things like that. I try to find nice big open fields where, you know, unless I was closing my eyes and pulling the trigger full throttle, I'd probably hit something, but anyway. No bent chassis, no bent tie rods, no bent shock shafts, no bent CVDs, and I've been pretty impressed with the durability of this thing. If you just, you know, I think this was $350 when I got it. Now they're closer to $5. But if you, you know, just want something to go out and bash and want maybe the potential to like do some mods and maybe try to throw a truggy body on here, I think you could probably even get some kind of short course thing to fit if you play around with some different body post mounts. You could probably have a pretty versatile kit that you can probably take to the track and at least have fun with, and then you can also go out and bash with, and it's not so much money where you're like, I would never take that bashing, it's $1,000. And so, and then you can kind of get your feet wet in the 8-scale world, and with it being a little bit lighter than a monster truck, a little bit smaller tires than a monster truck, that you're not putting so much strain on everything with the driveline all that your parts kind of will tend to last a little longer. So as far as maintenance is concerned, you will, you'll be a little cheaper in your maintenance and running of it. And it may not be like, I would prefer a monster truck now having this buggy again, but as far as overall maintenance costs, this thing is way less expensive to maintain. And so that's kind of nice. So just something to consider. And you know, there's a lot of 8-scale buggies out there, and there's not a lot of RTRs that are available that are kind of decent. There's a team associated one, which actually shares the same differentials, I believe, as this, or maybe some of the same parts. It's about the same price now, so that's a pretty good one. And then other than that, I can't think of anything that's ready to run. It's not a name brand or even close to it. So I hope this helps make a decision about, you know, getting into 8-scale or getting something to bash with. If you were to say, you know, what would you prefer? I prefer the MT4 just as far as like fun factor. But if you want something, like I said, a little less in overall maintenance costs, then this is a great choice. It's still fast, you know, it's like 40 miles an hour, which is plenty fast for me. It jumps well, it handles pretty well, it's tough. And one thing it doesn't do compared to the MT4 is the MT4 is really nice because you can do backflips and you can have a lot of air control, but just very minimal throttle response. But you also can get really out of control fast, and you can start, you know, whipping the thing back and forth and kind of lose where you're at and end up on your nose. When this one here flies fairly flat from the beginning, so even though you're not going to be having all this like trick, you know, maneuvers in the air, you also don't have as high chance of landing weird because you are starting off at a more controlled attitude. So I can't really think of anything else that I can say about it. You know, it's your typical easy to work on, you know, it's just a few screws to pop the diffs out if you do have to maintain them. Pretty straightforward. The manual, they have this, I think I might have showed it in this in the review, it has, you know, some tuning options you can do, how it affects the way the vehicle drives, whether you, you know, your anti-squat and your roll center and shock mounting and toe-in and all that jazz in here. And then they give you a little speed controller programming sheet manual, and then they give you something on the motor, which is pretty much useless. And then they call it maintenance manual and parts catalog, and it shows you how to tear apart and reassemble your kit. And it also has a parts listing of all the parts and part numbers and everything, and then it also shows you here in just a list form. So it's, and then some optional parts that they have available. So it's a pretty good parts catalog. I mean, compared to some of the others I've seen out there, it's pretty well put together, and pretty convenient. They did have this addendum. I think they changed the way the sway bars mount or something. And they threw this on here to make sure you get the right plate to support the sway bar. But I don't have to do sway bar, so it doesn't matter to me. So I pointed out. So thanks for watching, and hopefully I'll get some more running videos up and another review long term about how it holds up. Well, maybe after summer, see how it holds up after the summer. One more thing I did. But I think it's a 12 tooth pinion gear, 12 or 13, I put a 14 on there. And in the winter, it's a perfect, it's almost gear too low. It's like, I think I was getting top temps, 130, maybe 150 running like two batteries back to back. Last weekend it was like 72 degrees here, which is, you know, pretty nice spring day for us. I think after about a 15 minute run on a battery pack, I was seeing temperatures around 150, which is still pretty good, but I don't know if you could run two back-to-back packs and not overheat it. I have to see if I can, but maybe if you let it cool for like 5 minutes between the runs, that would be probably fine. So I'll let you know how that works. Thanks for watching.